making a few last-minute adjustments. How's everyone doing? We'll be trying as best we can, this format's new to us, to follow along with your comments and maybe respond as well. So feel free to share with us as we play. We'd love to hear what you're all thinking and how you're all doing. We're trying to get the live stream comments pulled up on Ben's phone so that we don't have to squint across the room at a teensy tiny laptop. So if you see us peering at phones, it's not out of rudeness, it's out of our desire for involvement.
Maureen says hi.
Hi, Maureen.
Hi, everyone. I'm Ben.
And I'm Rebecca.
And we both are lucky enough to play with the New Bedford Symphony regularly.
Who are our gracious live stream hosts for this evening.
Yes, thank you to the New Bedford Symphony for having us on this concert series. We are streaming to you from Rebecca's home in Cambridge. And this is a new thing for us, maybe a new thing for you. It's not the same as a live concert experience, obviously, but it does have the benefit of us getting to interact with you via the comments Rebecca was just talking about. So if you're watching this on Facebook, please comment. We'd love to interact with you in a way that we're not able to do while we're on stage. The other benefit of having your phone on your stand is you can see when your friends text you. The other benefit of watching the concert from your home, pour yourself a drink, relax. We are here to be your entertainment for the evening.
And no lines at the bathroom, that's another plus.
So many pluses. So, shall we tune?
I think we shall, yeah.
All right. Let's make that part of the regular concert experience. Mozart. When he was 19, Mozart wrote this duet for bassoon and cello, two instruments that don't really get to enjoy having the melody much in symphonies by Mozart, a little bit in opera, not so much in chamber music, and as it turns out, they don't get to enjoy the melody tonight either because we stole it from them. So this is all three movements of Mozart's duet in B-flat for bassoon and cello.
Thank you.
outside are enjoying it. That's why they honk.
Oh, I hear the bus.
Other things you don't get to experience in a concert hall.
Schubert. So this brings us to our Schubert leader portion of the program. We've decided to feature, among other things, a set of songs from his song cycle, Die Schöne Müllerin. So with Die Schöne Müllerin, Schubert wrote this in 1823, maybe? We don't know. Around 1823.
I think so. Mid 1820s.
And the general synopsis is that there is an apprentice miller, and he goes on an adventure, and on this adventure becomes enamored with a senior miller's daughter. We'll see how that goes for our apprentice miller. But to start, we have Das Wandern, where our Millers, our apprentice Millers' adventure begins. And these, this song in particular, and you know, this was a common technique employed by Schubert in general, you'll actually hear elements of the lyrics in the viola, which is the piano part. The oboe, in general, has taken the part of the voice. So in Das Wandern, our Miller protagonist sings about being inspired by the brook that runs through the mill to always, you know, go on new adventures, and being inspired by the wheel that is turning the water of the mill. And we only do two verses for you today, but that he also would sing about, you know, the stones grinding the flour, etc. and so forth. Here's Das Wandern. Schöne Müllerin, which are Trockene Blumen and Der Müller in der Bach, translating to Withered Flowers and The Miller in the Stream. Our Miller, he sings about an elaborate death fantasy. When his love is unreturned, he imagines that he dies and is buried with the dried and withered flowers that his love interest gave to him. And when the seasons turn and spring returns, the flowers that were dead and buried with him will bloom and live again. And in our final song, Der Müller in der Bach, the Müller returns to the same brook where his adventure started in Das Wandern, and contemplates finding peace within its cool waters. So here is Trockene Blumen and Der Müller in der Bach.
Thank you.
Artie Schaefer says, "You've made a new instrument, the Obiola." Oh, I like that.
How do you know it's not the never mind.
The Vobo.
The Vobo.
These are the kinds of comments we wish we had while we were on stage, but now you can do it in real time.
Alright.
Oh, my turn.
Well, your turn.
So we mentioned Schubert, like Mozart, lived a tragically short time, but that didn't stop him from composing 9 symphonies and 600 songs. He's incredibly prolific. He had a gift for melody, which is prominent in all of his symphonic works, and hopefully is on display tonight, even without lyrics. But speaking of lyrics, our next song, Der Heidenroslein? Heidenroslein, or Wild Rose. This tune may be familiar to you once you start hearing it, but we thought we'd just take a second and read all 3 verses of what we're about to play, since you don't have the lyrics in front of you. Or maybe you do, since you can get online. You're already online.
Extra credit if you do. The extra credit is another drink. Yeah. You can pour for yourself.
A boy saw a wild rose growing in the heather. It was so young and as lovely as the morning. He ran swiftly to look more closely, looked on it with great joy. Wild rose, wild rose, wild rose red, wild rose in the heather. Said the boy, "I shall pluck you, wild rose in the heather." Said the rose, "I shall prick you, so that you will always remember me, and I will not suffer it." And the impetuous boy plucked the wild rose from the heather. The rose defended herself and pricked him, but her cries of pain were to no avail. She simply had to suffer. So upbeat for a rose getting murdered.
We all like getting flowers, though.
I wonder if there's a flower emoji. Hint, hint.
There are many.
Okay.
There's even a rose. So our next piece of our Schubert Lieder portion is from his song cycle Winterreise, called Frühlingstraum. Frühlingstraum translates to dreams of spring, and you know, in winter, in Winterreise, you know, the gist of it is we have another wanderer, similar to in Die Schöne Müllerin, and again, just like in Die Schöne Müllerin, surprise, he is unlucky in love, and in Frühlingstraum, dreams of spring, our protagonist is asleep, and he's dreaming of the beautiful, warm spring flowers, and all of a sudden he's awoken rudely by ravens and roosters, depending on the verse, on his rooftop. And when he awakes, he realizes that it's still the dead of winter, and he's without his beloved. But as his eyes are adjusting, he sees his windowpane and the beautiful patterns that have been traced by the ice crystals that resemble the leaves and the flowers of springtime. And he, you'll hear this beautiful childlike simplicity to illustrate his awe and, you know, his appreciation of that beautiful moment. And he wonders how they got there, these ice crystals. And he also wonders when he'll see his beloved again.
Thank you.
expert leader, or lead, singular leader, I suppose, is Dubis Deru, Thou Art My Peace. We both really love this one particular moment, well, many moments, but one in particular in Dubis Deru, where, you know, all throughout this movement, the viola, the piano, has running sixteenths, and they're not turbulent, they're gently undulating, but toward the end, the lyrics state, what could be more restful than silence? And you'll hear this beautiful, these two beautiful, just pure chords, almost out of time, completely out of texture, followed by just silence. And we hope that you'll enjoy that moment as much as we do.
A little bit of peace in this crazy world. Ooh, somebody said more music should be written for this duo. Somebody. Laura, the instruments and the people. Keep the comments coming.
Yeah, what else are people saying?
How are you guys passing your time? We all seem to be, well, many of us seem to be having a lot more time on our hands these days. So it's always interesting to know what people are up to. Inventing new drinks, planting new plants.
Sourdough starters.
Oh, sourdough.
Cutting your own hair. We'd love to thank the New Bedford Symphony for hosting this live stream. It's a wonderful opportunity. We've learned so much, including how much we should be appreciating people who do audiovisual stuff for a living. That's been quite a process. And we'd also, you know, for those of you who have Facebook, please check them out. New Bedford Symphony on Facebook. They've been doing some really amazing things, especially lately, for the community of the New Bedford area, the South Shore, and they're a great organization to be involved with. And, you know, that said, if you find yourself able, we would really appreciate, you know, not just for New Bedford Symphony, but for all arts organizations for whom this is a very perilous time. If you've ever gone to a concert or enjoyed an event, consider giving what you can to that organization, and they will be extremely grateful for your support now and always. So that brings us to the final portion of our program.
Yeah, we wanted to finish tonight's concert with a couple of our favorite piano works by Brahms, whose 187th birthday was yesterday.
Happy birthday, Brahms.
These are two intermezzos from his Opus 119, written late in his life, around the time when he was writing chamber music for clarinet, and which later became adapted for viola. He never got around to writing any chamber music for oboe and viola, but I hope you'll agree that he really missed an opportunity. If he could have heard this, he would have written so much more. So without ado, let's do the first intermezzo.
Yeah, you know, that reminds me, you know, we've obviously, you know, transcribed, and not just transcribed, really arranged all this music ourselves and modified it to suit our instruments. If there's anything that you've heard where you've been thinking, man, I wish I could hear that on the oboe and viola, let us know. Or any other songs you'd like to hear on these concerts in general. We would be very curious to know what you want to hear.
Thank you.
Rebecca said, it's been a really great experience to arrange all of this program for our two instruments. I've learned a lot. Maybe the first thing I learned is that the viola is not a piano, which seems really obvious until you take the piano score and you sit down with your partner and you say, how about you play the left hand of the piano? And she says,
no,
I'm not a piano. So, emphasis on arranging these pieces and not transcribing them quite literally. It's given us a small insight into what it, first of all, makes it important to make some decisions, interpretation about what you consider is important. What do you leave out? What do you put in? Who do you give it to? And that's been a little small insight into the decisions composers have to make when they're scoring for more than one instrument. Brahms gets a reputation for being kind of serious and maybe autumnal and a downer like that last one, but I think he has a fun side too, which hopefully comes out in this third intermezzo, our last piece on the program.
Concerts happening, so if you enjoyed this one, you may enjoy, well, many others to come. Thanks and have a great night. Here we go. How do I turn it off?
And live.
And live.